Now we will discuss line coding. If we want to transmit some digital data from one place to another place, first of all, we have to convert this digital data into equivalent electrical signal because our communication system is electrical. So the conversion of this data, digital data, into equivalent electrical signal is the line coding. And that process is the line coding, and the electrical signal that we will got after line coding is the line code or the data format. Now various type of data formats are there, but any data format must have some desirable properties. And for a particular data format, we may not get all the desirable properties, but as per line coding is concerned, we must have certain desirable properties, and our objective is to select a particular line code that will satisfy most of the desirable conditions, desirable properties. So first desirable property is the self-synchronization. There should be enough timing information built into the code so that bit synchronizers that we have already discussed, bit synchronizer, can be designed to extract the timing or the clock information. A long series of binary 1 or 0 should not create any problem in time recovery. This is what we call the self-synchronization. Next is the low probability of bit error. Low probability of bit error. Receivers can be designed that will recover the binary data with a low probability of bit error when the input data signal is corrupted by noise or ISI. We will discuss ISI later on. Next is suitable spectrum for the channel. Properties of different channels are different. Type of coupling, bandwidth, all those properties are important parameters for the channel. The line coding must be compatible with the properties of the channel. Like if the channel is AC coupled, the power spectral density of the line code should be negligible at frequencies near zero. That should be. Also, the bandwidth of the signal needs to be sufficiently small compared to the channel bandwidth to avoid ISI or inter-symbol interference. So this is what you call the suitable spectrum for the channel. Next is the transmission bandwidth. Transmission bandwidth. Generally, the transmission bandwidth must be as small as possible, because if the transmission bandwidth is larger, we must have a channel that will support larger bandwidth. So that will either the designer have to use a number of carriers, or the client has to buy large bandwidth. So to avoid all those confusions, the transmission bandwidth of the line coding must be as small as possible. Next one is error detection capability. Error detection capability. It should be possible to implement this feature easily by the addition of channel encoders and decoders, or the feature should be incorporated into the line code itself. For example, if we consider the case of alternate mark inversion, you will see later on that it has got certain amount of error detection capability. If there is some problem in transmission of logic ones, it can be detected easily with the help of this alternate mark inversion. And finally, the transparency. The data protocol and the line code are designed so that every possible sequence of data is faithfully and transparently received. Now, what we do, as I mentioned, that a huge number of line coding are there, but we are not going to discuss all of them. So what we do, we divide this whole line coding into several categories, and we will try to discuss each line, one line coding from each of those categories. So with respect to amplitude variation, we can classify line coding into two classes. First one is the unipolar, and second one is the bipolar. What is the meaning of unipolar? Unipolar means the electrical signal will contain only one kind of potential. That means if we consider we want to transmit with the help of positive voltage, so unipolar signaling will contain only the positive voltage. But for bipolar, it will contain both polarity. That means in certain period of time it will contain positive polarity, and certain period of time it will contain the negative polarity. Example of unipolar system, unipolar data format, is unipolar NRZ. And for this one, maybe bipolar RZ. These are two examples of this bipolar and unipolar data format. Now, if we consider from the time point of view, we can divide this line coding into two categories. One is non-return to zero, second one is return to zero. What is the meaning of that? Non-return to zero means within a bit period the potential will not reach to the zero level. But for return to zero, it means that in one bit period, within one bit period, maybe at certain period of time or earlier, the potential will change from a particular value to zero. So these are the example of, these are the meaning of this RZ. An example may be unipolar NRZ and bipolar RZ. These are the example of these two type of data format. Now we will try to discuss different type of data format one by one in a brief fashion, not in details. To understand different type of data format, we arbitrarily have chosen a data sequence is the binary data 1101001. We could have chosen different data sequence. Now just consider this unipolar NRZ. Unipolar means it will contain only a particular type of potential, say positive potential. And NRZ means within a bit period, this is the bit period, within this bit period, it will never return to zero. Now in unipolar NRZ, logic 1 is represented by a voltage, say A, for total bit time, say TB. And zero, logic 0, is represented by 0 volt. So the first data is 1 1. So unipolar NRZ, since it is 1 1, it will continue like this with positive A voltage again. Then we have 0 means 0 volt. Then we have 1 means A volt. Then two zeros are there, so 0 0, and then 1 is there. For that we have an again A volt. So in this way the sequence will continue. Now consider the polar NRZ. In some books it is mentioned as bipolar NRZ, but I am mentioning this as polar NRZ. Polar means bipolar. For polar NRZ, since it is NRZ, it will again will not come back to zero within the bit period. And bipolar means it will contain both the potential, positive and negative. Now according to this polar NRZ, the logic 1 will be represented by plus A volt. A may be anything, 2 volt, 3 volt, 5 volt, whatever may be. We are representing this as A. So it will be represented by plus A volt for total time period TB. And 0 will be represented by minus A volt for the total time period, bit period TB. So our bit was 1101001. So accordingly, we will start from 1. 1 means plus A volt. Again we have 1 plus A volt. Then we have 0 minus A. Then we have 1 plus A. Then we have minus 0, sorry. Then we have 0, logic 0, so minus A. Then we have again logic 0, minus A volt. And final bit is logic 1, so it will be plus A volt. So this is what we call the polar NRZ. Now consider the situation of unipolar RZ. Since it is RZ, it means it will return to the 0 volt, zero line within the bit period. So starting from 0, it will go up to TB by 2, half the bit period, and then it will suddenly change its potential to 0 and it will continue for the rest of the period. So this is what we call the RZ. Now this one is unipolar RZ. That means it will contain a single kind of potential, single polarity. So logic 1 is represented by plus A volt for half bit period and 0 by the later half bit period. So this is what we call the unipolar RZ, and 0 is represented by 0 volt. So as per our data, first two bits are 1, so it will continue like plus A volt for half bit period, then it will come back to 0. Next bit is again 1, so it will continue to A and then it will come back to 0 level. Next bit is 0, so it will be 0 volt. Next bit is 1, so first half bit period it will be plus A and then it will be 0. Next two bits are 0, so 0 volt, 0 volt. Final bit is 1, so it will again plus A volt for the half bit period, and then it will come back to 0 and it will continue and it will complete its total period. So this is unipolar RZ. Next is the bipolar RZ. This bipolar RZ is also called the alternate Mark inversion or AMI. Here, logic 1 is represented by plus minus a volt for half beat period and 0 volt for later half period. Again, I am telling, logic 1 is represented by plus minus a volt. That means logic 1 may be plus a volt or minus a volt for the first half beat period, and later half beat period will be 0. And 0 will be represented by 0 volt. So let us see how it works, why it is called alternate mark. Mark means 1. Logic 1 is the mark. So our first beat was 1, second beat was 1. So for the first beat, for bipolar RZ, it will start from plus a volt and it will continue up to the half beat period TB by 2. Then it will come back to 0 and it will continue up to the total beat period TB. Now second beat is again 1. So what happens? It will never continue to plus A. Rather, it will go to the negative. It will take the negative value. That is why it is called alternate. So first one will be represented by positive potential and the second one will be represented by, next one will be represented by minus A for the half beat period and 0 for the later half beat period. Third beat is 0, so it is 0 volt. Fourth beat is 1. Now you can see that the previous one was represented by minus a volt, negative polarity. So the next one will be represented by positive polarity. So in this way, alternately, whenever one will appear, alternately it will change its polarity. So during transmission, if somehow, if we get two positive polarities successively, then any one of them is in error. So this one is having some kind of error detection capability. So the fourth bit is 1, that will be represented by positive polarity for TB by 2 time, and later half it will be 0. Next bit is 0, so 0 volt. Next bit is 0, so 0 volt. Final bit is again 1, and the previous bit was represented by positive polarity, so the next one will be represented by negative polarity. So in this way it will change. Now you will consider Manchester encoding. It's the Manchester NRZ signaling. In Manchester encoding, what is done is, for logic 1, for first half beat period, it will be represented by plus a volt, and for the later half beat period, it will be represented by minus a volt. And for 0, the first half beat period will be represented by minus a volt, and the second half beat period, latter part, will be positive. That means logic 1 means it will go from positive A to negative A, and for 0 it will go from negative A to positive A. That means within a bit period, whatever may be the value of the logic state, maybe 1, maybe 0, there will be a state change, there will be a polarity change. In every bit period there will be a polarity change. This is the characteristics of Manchester NRZ. Now we will try to understand basic features of different type of line coding that we have already gone through. We have already seen the waveforms for those line coding, and we'll try to discuss some features of those line coding. So first we will consider unipolar inner Z. Unipolar inner Z. Here, the power spectral density can be written as a square TB by 4 sine pi f TB by pi f TB whole square 1 plus 1 by TB delta f. And if you plot it, PhD for unipolar inner Z, it will be something like this. So it will be 0 at the frequency of R. R is the bit rate. This one is twice R. This one is 0.5 TB. And here we have a spike. And the weight of the spike is half. So this is the power spectral density for this unipolar inner set. As you can see from this power spectral density, that unipolar inner Z is having some DC value. This is a DC component. At zero frequency means it is a DC component. And this DC is not carrying any information. So there is a loss of, or rather wastage of power due to this DC component. Not only that, the spectrum is not approaching zero near DC. That means it contains higher amount of power near lower frequency range. So to transmit this unipolar inner Z, we need a DC coupling circuit. So that's the problem of this particular kind of data format. On the other hand, it is very easy to generate using TTL and CMOS circuits. And since it is unipolar, it requires only one kind of power supply, either positive or negative. For our example, we have taken it as positive, so only positive power supply is required. Negative power supply is not necessary. Now we will consider the polar inner set. Polar inner set. Polar inner set signaling. Here, the power spectral density takes this form: a square TB sine pi f TB by pi f TB whole square. and its spectral density, if we plot it, it will be something like this. This is frequency. This value is dB. This one is 0. As you can see that the power spectral density in this case also is having large amount of power near 0, though there is no DC component like this one. There is no DC component. Its Fresnel bandwidth is R. Here also the Fresnel bandwidth is R. So now let us consider few features. This signal is relatively easy to generate, but it requires both type of power supply, positive and negative. Since it is polar, that means bipolar in nature, so it requires both kind of power supply. Then the beat error probability for this case is superior compared to this one or some other kind of data format. Now we will consider the unipolar RZ. We have already seen the waveform. So in this case, power spectral density takes this form, a square TB by 16 sine pi f TB by 2 by pi f TB by 2 whole square into 1 plus 1 by TB summation n equal to minus infinity to plus infinity delta f minus n by TB. Now if we plot this, this plot is more important actually. This is the PhD, and it will be something like this. We have two spikes. Its weight is 0.1, and here the weight is 1/4, and this value is 0.5 of TB. Maximum value is 0.5 of TB. Now if you consider this power spectral density, you can see that for unipolar RZ that we are discussing, unipolar RZ, we have is DC value. This one is the DC value. And once we have the DC value, we need a DC coupling circuit. That's the problem. Not only that, we have another spike here. Small spike, but it is there. It's a very small spike. But the spike is appearing at a frequency of R. R is the bit rate. And this spike is actually used to generate the clock frequency. So for unipolar RZ, it is easier for us to generate the clock frequency using synchronizer circuit. Because of this presence of this spike. Another thing you must note that the first null bandwidth is now twice R. Unlike previous one, it was R. But here we have the larger bandwidth. So bandwidth requirement of unipolar RZ is double that of the previous one. So these are the features of this unipolar RZ. Now you will consider the bipolar RZ. Alternate Mark inversion. The power spectral density can be written as a square TV by 4 into sine pi f TV by 2 divided by pi f TV by 2 whole square sine square pi f TV. If we plot it, this is the PhD, this is TB, so it is 0.5 TB. In that case, you see that it will peak at R by 2, then we have first null at frequency R and so on. So this is the power spectral density. Now you can see this power spectral density reveals that there is no DC component here. And since there is no DC component, so there is no problem of stray voltage. Not only that, we don't require any DC coupling circuit. Not only that, the power near DC, near this region, is very small. So the transmission of this bipolar RZ is comparatively easier compared than this previous one. Now the power spectral density is peaking at, taking its peak at R by 2. Now what is the benefit of that? If we pass this bipolar signal through a rectifier, that will increase its frequency from R by 2 to R, which is the clock frequency. So here also we can use this type of rectification circuit to determine the clock sequence, and it is very easy. Now, as we mentioned earlier, that this bipolar RZ is having three distinct voltage level, plus A, 0 and minus A. But this plus and minus A was represented by logic 1, representing logic 1. That means logic 1 is represented by both plus A and minus A. That means it is apparent that it has got three different levels, but actually they are representing two levels. That is why this bipolar RZ is also called pseudo ternary. That means it is not exactly ternary, but it appears as it is a ternary. But point is that here we have to distinguish, the receiver has to distinguish three distinct levels, plus A, 0 and minus A. Not only that, transmitter must have a power supply of both the polarity. So these are the problems associated with this signaling. The bipolar signal requires approximately 3 dB more signal power than the polar signal for the same probability of bit error. So these are the features of this bipolar RZ. At last we will discuss Manchester NRZ. We have already seen its waveform. Now we will consider its spectrum, power spectral density is to take this form sine of pi f dB by 2 divided by pi f dB by 2 whole square sine square pi f dB by 2. So if you plot it, this is the power spectral density with respect to frequency, and you can see that the spectrum will be like this at frequency 2R, it will be 0, and at frequency R, it will be maximum. Not only that, near zero frequency, the power level is very small, so we don't require any DC coupling circuit. The problem of this Manchester encoding is that its bandwidth is larger, it is twice R. Now, since it is peaking at frequency R, that means it is easy to recover the clock. Another advantage of this Manchester encoding is that if you consider this one or previous few number of signaling type, if we have a long string of 0 or 1, we may lose the synchronization, because long string of 0 or 1 may lead to the synchronizer may not work properly, particularly when we have long chain of zeros, long sequence of zeros. But here, because in this case, if you have long chain of zeros, long sequence of zeros, there is no change in the voltage value, and that is why we may have some problem of synchronization. But here, irrespective of logic 1 or 0, we have already seen the waveform, irrespective of logic 1 or 0, there will be a state change. And since there is a state change, irrespective of 0 and 1, there is no chance that we can lose the synchronization problem, synchronization. So here, self-synchronization property is very, very strong. So these are the features of Manchester NRZ.